Why did you join the regiment?
So I grew up watching the reenactments.
I actually saw the 10th Regiment of Hook at the Lexington Battle, and I heard the drums going up Mass Ave, entering the green, and just the sound and the power of the drums led me to want to do it.
I've been going to the Patriots Day reenactment with my best friend, Allie Filatico.
What keeps you coming to events?
So there's nothing quite like this hobby. There's a great community around it, a great group in the 10th Regiment of Foot, and in my own personal community, the musicians, the fifes and drums, we depend on each other, we rely on each other, and I just have a great time performing with them and teaching them.
There's always jokes, there's always laughter, there's seriousness, we take it seriously. Everybody's, you know, the biggest reason is because everybody is so in love with just the practice of doing what we do.
I think the camaraderie between all the people, these are people that are friends but have become closer than that. They're more like family, so it's a nice family feel when we come to events.
What is your favorite memory of being in the regiment?
Oh, that's hard. That's really hard. You know what it was? When I was at Fort Number 4, then recruit Manny Gonzalez, he walked me around Fort Number 4, and it was late at night. It was like probably 1 a.m. Everybody in the regiment was partying and stuff, and like I was about to go to college, and Manny Gonzalez is a former cop. He's a dad, he's like a great son, and he walked with me around the fort like 8 or 10 or 12 times. Like, we circled the fort like 12 times, talking about life, love, women, men, marriage, college, you know, how to be safe, like how to just like handle stuff. And I'm an older brother, like I have a younger brother, but Manny became my older brother in that moment, and like I know that he'd have my back forever. And literally, even though I can tell 1,000 battle stories about the regiment, my favorite is like are those moments when we're just like human and talking, and we give each other life and we tell each other life.
I think this Patriots Day really showed how strong we are. It was cold, like 30 degrees, it was a downpour, it was miserable, it was the least ideal conditions possible for reenacting. But we showed up as a whole. Why? Because we're a family. And you know what? I may have been worried about the forecast that morning, but I was never worried about the 10th foot, because deep in my heart, I knew we all had the same drive, the same passion to teach our history. And what I love so much about the regiment is that we may all follow different paths in life. Some of us are teachers, doctors, professors, some of us are still in school, but we can all come together and work for a common cause, and that's special. I think that morning really proved how dedication and family can overcome any obstacle, no matter the temperature, no matter the weather. And we went out on the green that morning and we put on a hell of a show, and that's why I love the 10th foot so much. Soon after Lexington, the regiment would leave for Concord. The highlight of the weekend was being able to help a 14-year-old boy named John McConnell fulfill his life's dream. He was born with muscular dystrophy, a rare disease that confines him to a wheelchair, but it did not confine his heart. Through the Make-A-Wish Foundation, he was able to travel all the way to Lexington from Alaska to live his dream of drumming in a reenactment. All week, he was given tours and front row seats to events, but the reenactment he was supposed to participate in got canceled last minute due to the rain, but that did not stop him nor the reenacting community. We rallied around John and decided to host a ceremony anyway. Even though this was the last event of the weekend, it was raining harder than ever, temperatures were cold and our uniforms were wet and dirty, it was by far the most meaningful. Especially for our drum sergeant Anthony Jenkins, who had spent 6 months helping him prepare for this moment.
By the authority invested in him by the 10th Regiment, Lieutenant Colonel Robert J. Filatico does hereby issue this warrant to John McConnell and appoint you as drummer in the Colonel's company of His Majesty's 10th Regiment of Foot in America and command you to perform this duty in the said regiment with your best endeavors and to observe and obey His Majesty's orders and the orders of the generals and officers set over you by His Majesty. Given at the North Bridge in Concord, Mass, on the 16th day of April, this year of our Lord, 2018. Three cheers for Drummer, Drummer McConnell! Hop up!
Huzzah! Huzzah! Huzzah!
So the Make-A-Wish Foundation, Jim Hollister at the National Park, and John's family themselves reached out to me in October about teaching John the basic commands, just so he could take part in the Patriots Day activities in 2018. His wish was obviously to come down to Alaska to be the drummer. And since he was coming from such a distance, I figured just teaching him commands just wouldn't do it. It was too easy. I think such a thing would only have taken 1 or 2 hours. So in the end, I wanted to basically teach him everything I could to be a regular fife and drum drummer. I pulled out the music from the 4-H Fife and Drum Corps Recruit Music Syllabus. I sent him over the command sheet that I used for the drummers in the 10th Regiment, and then I taught him some of the marching cadences, such as the Long March, and stock beats, such as Baltimore, so that he could adapt quickly to music that was being played. And as we found out, he would be playing a lot more than expected, and I think some of that is to do with the fact that he was ready. So John put in a lot of work on his own, and even though, you know, we had lessons an hour every week,
he put in the work himself to make sure he was ready for these. Because you just don't learn a new instrument 1 hour a week. So the way that we learned commands was fun. I have metal cast soldiers that are painted as the 10th Regiment of Foot. And conveniently, these soldiers are in the prime position, the make-ready position, and the present and fire positions. So I would hold these up to the screen, and John would play the corresponding command. And sometimes I would mix up the order. I would hold up the present first, and then I would hold up prime and load. And then sometimes I would go in order, but I would tell John, we have to wait because the soldiers are loading the muskets. And I would then mime loading a musket so that he would get used to the timing. So our sessions were scheduled to last an hour, but the reality is they almost never lasted an hour. They lasted closer to an hour 30, an hour 45, because John just kept asking questions about history, about Boston, about the reenactments, about the local traditions, about what he was getting himself into, about the groups that were involved, about the 10th Regiment, about the active Minutemen who he would go on to march with. And we just went on and on and on about history. And his mother would jump in at times at this time, and we would all talk about just what was awaiting John here in New England in April. So I really got to know him and his family during these sessions, and meeting them for the first time before the Make-A-Wish Gala was absolutely amazing. It was a really weird sensation of meeting people you've known for about half a year for the first time. And I could just tell that from that moment that it was going to be a fantastic wish, because John was just so excited to be there. I brought a small drum with me. I borrowed a drum from 4-H. We strapped it onto him. And his father actually wheeled him around the big room we were in, and he was playing on the drum, and it was just great. He was playing the Long March. That's just what he gravitated towards. And the next night, we would actually perform together. We played the Long March, and we played Baltimore for Moon and Seven Stars. And we were actually thrown a curveball. We only prepared Moon and Seven Stars, but John was ready, and we played Yankee Doodle set to the Long March, and it was great. And it was just a testament to the work that he put in, that he could just pull the Long March out, and he played it with confidence, and we sounded great at the Make-A-Wish event. So Patriots Day itself comes along, and of course we all know that it effectively got rained out. But then the community came together, and the community made sure that it didn't get rained out. All of us were lobbying and pulling people in and making sure that everyone knew to be at the Concord Visitor Center at 8:30 a.m. on Patriots Day. And everyone showed up. Everybody showed up. Whether they were on the colonial side or the British regular side, everyone was there. And then we all marched down together. John led the column, playing the Long March as we practiced. We wheeled John out. Right in the middle of the column, right on the bridge as planned, and he fired off three volleys with the commands that we reversed. And the smile on his face, I was right next to him, was amazing. And everyone who came out in that bad weather, the wind, the rain, the snow, the sleet, whatever it was coming down, they did it for him. And many resulting conversations I've had have all come to the same conclusion, that the weather made it special, because otherwise John would have just been a guest at everybody's Patriots Day. But instead, that Patriots Day belonged to him. It only happened because he was here. So everyone that was there on that bridge, everyone that was watching from the sidelines, everyone who wished they could have been there but couldn't, they made it possible. They made his wish possible. And I think that's a testament not only to the Make-A-Wish Foundation itself and just the power it has, but the community we have that goes above and beyond it. Now, everyone else on that bridge definitely saw John, and they were proud of John, and they're proud to be part of it, but it's tough for me even now to see John as a Make-A-Wish kid. It's tough for me to see him as a Duchesne's kid. I just don't. I see him as another drummer because of all the work that we did. All the conversations we had were focused on the music, about history, about what his hands were doing. It was purely teaching him as a drummer. And in that time, he became my little buddy. And so when I saw him out there, when he was wheeled off and he was looking up at us with a big smile, with a little 4-H drum strapped on his waist, you know, I definitely saw a lot of my childhood just right there. And that's what makes me most proud. Not that I helped someone with Duchenne's, but that I helped someone who wanted to have my childhood have that experience. And I think that image is going to last with me forever. And I was tearing up on the bridge, and it's 3 days later, and I still am whenever I think of that. And I am right now.
That was awesome.